Welcome. I'm told I can take this off while I'm talking. So I hope no one is offended by that. But welcome to the 2022 Monrovia State of the City. And it's so good to be back together again, isn't it? That's right. Who wants a repeat of 2021? Man, I just never thought it could be shut down as much as it was last year, but it's so nice to be here. And I know we have some people who, due to COVID, preferred to not be here in person, so they're watching from home, so give them a hand. And we also want to thank the good folks from LOOK, so give them a hand. They've been so gracious to welcome us into their home, and the best way to say thank you is to come down and watch a movie, right?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Okay, so I have a few things I need to say for just a moment. Each year, I get the pleasure of, along with the rest of the Monrovia City Council, to take a moment and look back over the year and reflect on what we've accomplished and maybe what we haven't. But some of the most relevant issues that the city's faced over the past year, you're gonna see tonight. And there's been a boatload of them. 2021 was never expected anywhere. So it's been very interesting. We've had a lot of challenges, but what a great time to be a Monrovian, isn't it? Yeah, so give yourselves a hand. So tonight, our invocation will be given by our city treasurer, Mr. Steve Baker. Please give Steve a hand and welcome him.
Thank you. This is safe. Thank you, Mayor Adams. Please bow your heads with me in prayer. O ruler of the universe, Lord God, look favorably upon those gathered here this evening and be present with us. We acknowledge you as the source of all, and we give thanks that you have blessed our city richly. We give you thanks for the resilience that has enabled us to weather the storm of this pandemic, and we ask that its shadow may soon be lifted from our lives. Let us pause and take a moment to remember those Monrovians who did not survive this pandemic. May their memories to us always be a blessing. As we turn to the future, inspire us continually with the same creative spirit that has enriched us in the past. Help us to resolve any differences we may have with understanding and mutual respect. Help us to embrace all Monrovians, whether they live within our city limits or not. Keep our city staff focused and innovative, and our police and fire personnel safe from any harm. Grant that we may continue on the pathway of success. These things we ask, invoking the power of your name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, thank you, Steve. Next up, the presentation of the colors. We have the Boy and Girl Scouts with us this evening, so I'd like to welcome them.
Call guard, attention. Call guard, mark time, march. Call guard, forward, march. Call guard, halt. Call guard, cross the colors. Call guard, post the colors. Scouts, face the flag. Scout, salute.
Those in uniform, please salute the flag. Those not in uniform, place your right hand over your heart and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Two.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at a twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bonds bursting. Still there, oh say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
Color Guard reform. Color Guard dismissed.
Give them a hand, please. You know, you always hear on the news about some of the negative things of our youth, and this is a classic example of our future's very bright. So thank you all. Okay, I get the terrible task of introducing all of the dignitaries that are here, although you're all very important. And if I miss somebody, I'll apologize now. And there's always someone. So, from the council, my colleagues, Mr. Blackburn, Mr. Spicer, Mrs. Shevlin, and probably one of the more important people at City Hall, Alice Adkins, our city clerk, and Steve Baker, our treasurer. We have many of our commissioners here this evening. Julie Bank from the Community Services Commission. Edward Belden. Fernando Villegas. From our Historic Preservation Commission, Edie Ramirez. Sergio Jimenez. Penny Zook. From our Planning Commission, Bill Schief, Daryl Brook, give him a hand, and Aaron Stahura. From our Measure K Committee, Brenda Traynor. From our Monrovia Renewal Citizens Advisory Committee, Bill Schief again.
And it's really cool that we have all five members of the Board of Education with us this evening. They're our partners. There isn't anything that doesn't go on in this town that doesn't involve both of us. So I'd like to introduce the current president, Celine Lockerbie. Vice President Tracy Golar. Board Member Jennifer Anderson. Board Member Rob Hammond. And Board Member Maritza Travanti. From the Chamber of Commerce, Judy Scheffler. And probably the most important person in the room this evening, my wife, Sally. There, I told you I would do it. So, we've got some exciting stuff to go over tonight. Did I miss anybody? Good. Okay. So, in our pursuit of excellence, the City Council dedicated themselves to improving our community through four strategic areas. Remember, last year was really, really marginal. But we still wanted to improve customer service, financial management, our infrastructure, right? When the whole nation was talking about who's going to fix our infrastructure, we did. And building better relationships. We, for some time, there were not joint meetings between the schools and the City Council. We brought those back. We brought back meetings with the Monrovia Arcadia Doherty Town Council. Because when the day's done, we're all in this together, right? We hand our children off to the schools and ask them to educate them and send them back. And it's our responsibility to help them. So we really wanted to build on those relationships. We closed the gaps in our services to reach all segments of our community. We revamped many of our events so they were bigger and better than ever. We bridged divides and rebuilt relationships. During the pandemic, when governments and health departments were shutting down businesses, closing parks, and canceling events, we worked tirelessly to find a way to keep life moving forward. In addition to strictly following safety protocols, which are important, we kept our parks open, found ways to add or expand programs. We supported our business community. We expanded outdoor dining. We closed streets, sidewalks, alleys, and parking spaces to ensure that these businesses had enough room to work. For our community, 2021 was our year to take the pandemic head on and to fight to resolve our issues and find solutions. And I think we did a pretty darn good job at that. But it wouldn't happen without so many of you that are in the room this evening. Our commissioners, our volunteers, our staff. You know, we kind of get more attention being at the top. But when the day's done, it takes all of us to make a community, right? So for this year's State of the City, your City Council will share an in-depth look into how we responded to each of these challenges. My hope is that you'll come to learn that even in the midst of crisis and chaos, our community will find a way to unite together. And I really mean that, to unite. Because a divided community, and there are people out there that would like to divide our community, a united Monrovia is stronger. Our community will find a way to unite together, to spread love and generosity, and demonstrate what a Monrovian really looks like. So on that note, I would like to invite up my colleague and a great member of our City Council, Mr. Alexander Blackburn.
As usual, after the mayor speaks, I have to lower the mic. I'd also like to thank the mayor for once again doing about half my speech. I've learned after 9 years on this council that maybe the only person who likes the limelight more than the mayor is Daryl Brooke. It's a close call, close call. One of the good things about this mayor is he knows how to put on an engaging presentation, and part of that is making a strong first impression. So naturally, he had me go first to talk about prudent financial management. Nothing could be sexier. Since this council has been together, one of our fundamental goals has been prudent financial management. And tonight I'll provide you with an update on some of the things that we have done to promote that goal. Let me get rid of this little attempt at a stand. In 2017, the city recognized that some decisions by CalPERS, the state retirement fund, had fundamentally altered the fiscal landscape for agencies who were participating in the program. Those decisions were going to cause the city's unfunded pension liability to rise more than previously anticipated for future years. Consequently, we needed to completely rethink our strategy for dealing with that liability. Of course, it wasn't just Monrovia facing this new challenge. All cities participating in CalPERS were facing the same challenge, and many of them faced the very real risk of bankruptcy as a result. In Monrovia, we acted quickly but thoughtfully. In November 2017, the City Council approved the CalPERS response plan. Our plan included all employees voluntarily paying more of their own pension benefits, increasing the city's transient occupancy tax to build more city revenue, creating and utilizing community facility districts, otherwise known as CFDs, in which new developments would pay more tax for general city services, and issuing pension bonds to pay off outstanding pension debt. Furthermore, in June 2021, we created a trust with an ongoing dedicated revenue stream that would be set aside on an annual basis to pay for future pension and other post-employment benefit liabilities. Because of these measures, we believe the city is well positioned to overcome the financial challenges posed by CalPERS. I'll now move on to Measure K, otherwise known as Keep Monrovia Revenue's local sales tax measure. Since its inception, we have collected $9,217,891 that was at risk of otherwise being taken outside of our agency for use outside of Monrovia. You can tell I'm new at this. I interrupted my applause there. I should have paused for the applause. Yeah. This had been Daryl up here, he would have got it perfect. No, just kidding. Thank you. We now have that money available to reinvest in Monrovia. Although we have collected those funds, the council did not rush to spend the money just because it was available to us. To that end, we have only allocated $3.2 million of the available $12 million. We allocated that money towards building our financial reserves, 5 one-time technology improvement projects, new batting cages at Barney Glen Baseball Field, and completing an ADA transition plan to ensure all city facilities are fully accessible to persons living with disabilities. Daryl, you want to? Enter an applause. Thank you. For sure. With regard to the remaining funds, as well as future Measure K funds to be allocated, the council is seeking input from the community on how it would like to see the money programmed. To that end, during the final months of 2021, city staff conducted dozens of meetings and discussions to determine resident priorities. In the coming weeks, the full results of our outreach will be shared and council will decide on a spending plan. Now, I'm sure at this point you're all on the edge of your seats, and you would like me to get even further into the financial weeds. I'm sure most of you are thinking, hey, we were going to grab a drink after this, but never mind. We hope the Blackburn gets into more of the financial minutiae here. But I don't want to steal all the thunder from my colleagues, so at this point I'll just reassure residents that as this council moves forward, we will continue exercising the same financial prudence we have to this point, and I'll yield the stage back to the mayor.
So I think I forgot to mention that this event started when Rob Hammond was mayor, and that must have been 15 years ago? 15 or 16 years ago. And Rob did such a great job of coming up with this idea that for several years we improved on it by offering free popcorn. The reason you got unpopped popcorn when you came in is the concern over people taking their masks off with fresh popcorn. So, Rob, I apologize that there's no popcorn this evening, but thank you. The other thing is the Monrovia family is about to gain a new member. If you haven't heard, Commissioner Daryl Brook is getting married in about 3 weeks. And his lovely soon-to-be bride is with him, Arlene. Give her a hand. And next I'm going to call on Mr. Spicer, Councilman Larry. Come on up.
Okay, good evening, Monrovia. I'd just like to give you a brief update about how Monrovia is the fourth oldest incorporated city in Los Angeles County. So I hope that you're not surprised to hear that it has an aging infrastructure and a backlog of deferred maintenance. To ensure that we are addressing infrastructure needs for years to come, the city developed its first citywide capital improvement program to define long-term ongoing capital infrastructure needs for both maintenance and replacement. Now, if you thought Monrovia renewal was significant, which it is, then we should all be excited for our future infrastructure plans. As a planning tool, this five-year $97 million program will address all infrastructure needs and future improvements. With that said, I'd like to share with you a few projects that we have in store that will begin soon. Since 2015, the city has contemplated making substantial improvements to the Monrovia Community Center. A resident survey showed over 50% of the 215 responses felt the community center needed some work. A resident survey showed over 50% of the 215 responses felt the community center does not meet the needs of the community. We have been working on our assessment and design for community center upgrade. Once complete, this assessment will include program and space analysis, building mass study, facade design study, a space planning and interior design concept, and high-level furnished concept plans. The city is ready with final plans and design for library enhancement project, which will include new, unique spaces, especially for kids, enclosing outdoor areas of the facility surrounding to activate indoor-outdoor space, creating a larger space for families to gather while attending programs, addressing security concerns. We are also finally installing a new restroom. Thanks to Los Angeles County Supervisor Catherine Barger, who allocated $150,000 for the project, Monrovia Library will soon have a Portland loo. The Portland loo is designed to be a durable, bare necessity public restroom with the intent of minimizing vandalism and illegal activities. As you may recall, the Portland Loo was installed at Julian Fisher Park in 2017, and the community has been very pleased with this functionality. There is no denying that parks make life better, but it became even more apparent over the years how vital open space is for the community. The city secured two grants totaling nearly $1 million to make needed improvements at Lucinda Garcia Park. The expanded the park to the open space area located at the west end of the facility, replace and upgrade the play equipment, add fall safety surfacing at the playground area, install exercise circuit equipment, repair the pathway, and upgrade landscaping at the park. install interpretive signage on the history of Lucinda Garcia Park, and what I had mentioned before, a demonstration garden with drought-tolerant and native species. So, for those who love reading and environment, the Monrovia Reads Vehicle Literacy Program has a new customized electric vehicle. This project was funded through a grant from the California State Library totaling over $74,000. The Monrovia Reads van brings with it the resources that our children need to enhance their lives through the power of knowledge. Since launching in March of 2018, the Monrovia Reads van brought library services to over 15,000 community members across Monrovia, including providing after-school library services at the 5 local elementary schools. The Monrovia Reads Mobile Literacy Program would not be possible without the ongoing support of our community partners, Monrovia Reads, Foothill Credit Union, the Library Foundation, and the Friends of the Monrovia Public Library. And there's more. As part of the city's overall ongoing commitment to maintain and improve its infrastructure and capital assets, here are a few projects completed this year. Old Town Monrovia is now home to 4 public EV charging stations. These level 2 EV charging stations are located at the public parking lot along the 100 block of East Lemon Avenue and is offering free charging through February 15th of this year. We plan to build many, many more EV charging stations in 2022 and beyond. This past summer, a groundbreaking was held on the future Town Place Marriott Suites coming to Monrovia in fall of 2022. The 109-room, 5-story building will welcome visitors to Monrovia and provide extended stay travelers a place that feels like home. In the fall, we began working on the Safe Routes to School project that includes improvements to the intersections of Lemon Avenue and Park Rose Avenue at the front of Brad Oaks Elementary School. Brad Oaks Elementary School now has a raised crosswalk, thermoplastic traffic markings that aim to improve pedestrian safety and reduce speed in a high traffic area, and also solar speed feedback signs. So I would like to thank you so much for allowing me to share details related to capital improvements we've made this year. Most importantly, we want to thank you for the immense amount of trust and patience you've given to us. So if you think 2021 was a busy year, stay tuned for 2022. And now I'd like to turn it back to Mayor Adams.
Happy birthday to who, Larry?
Oh, my wife.
Oh, there you go. Okay, Councilmember Crudgington could not be with us this evening, so she has recorded some comments that she would like to share with you, and I'll turn it over to her remotely. Thank you.
Good evening. It's been a tough few years for all of us. The challenges that we have had to face personally and as a community continue to linger even into the new year. When we look back, Monrovia has remained caring, innovative, and solution-oriented. Every challenge we have faced together has demonstrated that we are resilient. We all know the Bobcat fire began on September 6, 2020. In total, the fire burned more than 115,000 acres of the San Gabriel Mountains, including portions of the foothills directly above Monrovia, becoming the second largest wildfire in LA County's history. Monrovia suffered no loss of life or structures, but Monrovia Canyon Park was significantly damaged. Though the fire was put out by our wonderful firefighters, the city continues working on the fire by pursuing funding to ensure emergency response and rebuilding costs are not borne by our community alone. The city continues working with a number of agencies, including FEMA, the California Office of Emergency Services, and the Los Angeles Flood Control District. We developed a plan to protect the neighborhoods of Oaklade and Ridgeside Drives, as studies have shown they are prone to the possibility of mud and debris flow. To preserve the safety and security of residents and their homes, K-rail barriers and other diversion resources were installed in the area. Our goal is to keep all flows off private property and divert the mud and debris onto a street where it will be managed and removed. Having the K-rail installed in Monrovia Canyon Park was also necessary to keep everyone safe and to protect the area in the event of a mud or debris flow as a result of heavy rain. Since these barriers will most likely be in place for up to 5 years, we organized a paint party for community members to come together to beautify the K-rails and create a warm and welcoming space for all to enjoy. And how Monrovian is that? On August 30th, 2021, just 1 week shy of the Bobcat fire anniversary, we were thrilled to reopen Monrovia Canyon Park to the public. This was only possible due to the countless hours that staff and volunteers contributed to repairing trails, clearing fallen trees, painting facilities, and aiding in regrowth. We can't thank them enough. We were given the opportunity to enjoy the beautiful park for a few months before disaster struck again. In December of 2021, we received notice that a large storm was moving into the LA County area and was likely to cause significant damage. And our beloved Monrovia Canyon Park was significantly damaged. There are sections of roadway that are gone and culverts that are filled in. The stream has cut new paths through the park, and there are areas where 6 to 12 feet of earth has been washed away. Rocks of all sizes, some the size of minivans, are scattered throughout the park. In true Monrovia fashion, we are already preparing our work to clear out debris, remove silt, sediment, and rocks from the park, and begin to repair the damaged infrastructure. When Canyon Park is fully repaired, the infrastructure will be new and ready to host Monrovians again for many, many years to come. Our beloved Monrovia Canyon Park has been through so much, but while we can and will rebuild, we cannot do it without the help of many groups, volunteers, and community partners. For example, the Monrovia Parks, Wilderness, and Recreation Foundation has reconvened with a new mission to support recreation and community programs, parks, facilities, and open spaces in Monrovia. In 2021, they raised over $100,000, which they are putting to use in Monrovia. How amazing is that? Amigo de los Rios, a local environmental group, is busy pursuing grants to improve water quality and education around our public school buildings. Amigos, the city, and our school district are partnering together to improve water quality, which is a wonderful partnership. And Food Ed is partnering with the city and school district to teach our children and families about growing your own local healthy food. And did you know that Monrovian Brian Tyndall, who regularly walks Peck Park and collects trash, recently cleaned over 300 pounds of trash in one day? He follows in the footsteps of Monrovian Karen Suarez, who has organized Peck Park trash cleanups for years. These are all wonderful examples of Monrovians making a difference. As the chair of the Water Policy Committee for the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments, you know I have to talk about water, both water quantity and water quality. Despite the heavy rains in December, we cannot deny the drought conditions affecting our region. We are not alone. States across the western United States are all in desperate need of water. In summer 2021, Governor Newsom called upon the entire state to reduce water consumption by 15%. Council approved a phase two drought emergency, which not only imposes a 10% water reduction on all customers, but will charge a penalty for extra water use. The city is prohibiting excessive use of water while promoting conservation. Conservation is the least expensive way we can all increase our water supply. We are also looking to improve water quality for Monrovians. Measure W is a property tax initiative that generates funding for a comprehensive regional program to create safer, cleaner water. The program intends to clean billions of gallons of stormwater to protect our lakes, rivers, streams, coastal waters, storm channels, and beaches from trash and contaminants. We will protect our overall public health, build climate resiliency within the region through effective engineering and planning, and that includes a lot of attention to what we call urban heat effect. On an annual basis, this program generates approximately $285 million for all of LA County, which will fund local and regional programs. Locally, Monrovia receives $520,000 per year directly and is eligible to apply for competitive grant funding up to $32 million per year. To date, Monrovia has applied for and received approximately $4.7 million in competitive grant funding for two stormwater projects within our approved revised watershed management plan area, and an additional $2 million for a third project. And a big shout out to our staff for that. Before I sign off, I want to take a moment to say how inspiring it is to see how much Monrovia has accomplished to preserve our architectural heritage. Monrovians are passionate about our history and the city's historic preservation program, which continues to be very active. This past year, we dedicated the Farmer Club Fountain as a historic landmark. The Farmers Club Fountain has become a highly recognizable symbol of Old Town Monrovia and Library Park. The Monrovia Duarte Farmers Club was a group of civic-minded individuals who met during the first decade of the 20th century. While not well known, their lasting contribution to Monrovia was the construction and donation of the Farmer Club's fountain in 1909. In August 2013, the fountain was damaged during a car accident. but it was meticulously restored in partnership with the Monrovia Historic Preservation Group. Symbolizing that partnership, the fountain is still standing today at the northwest corner of Myrtle and Lime Avenues and is now a designated local historic monument. Way to go. If you want to learn more about Monrovia's history, please stop by the Monrovia Historical Museum, which recently reopened after an 18-month closure. During the hiatus, the museum enhanced their exhibitions with new features, including an updated Monrovia High School exhibit with yearbooks. Those might be fun to browse. A Monrovia Fire Department exhibit, an upcoming display on the city's diversity created in conjunction with Monrovia Changemakers, and so much more to come. Thank you for allowing me to join in virtually tonight. We have missed opportunities to celebrate and grieve together, and my fondest hope is that when we're through this, we'll be able to spend more time together, grieving and celebrating, and being Monrovians together. God bless you. Stay safe.
So if you run into Gloria, make sure you tell her what a great job she did. She was very saddened that she couldn't be with us, but a great presentation. Thank you, Gloria. You know, if we go for just a moment back to Larry's presentation about that Portland Loo, the reason it's called the Portland Loo is because it was designed up in the city of Portland, Oregon. And Becky Shevlin was so instrumental in getting funding from the county for the Portland Loo in Monrovia, that there was a movement to rename it in Monrovia the Shevlin Loo. Becky objected to that, and that you did, Chris?
Yeah.
Well, okay. So, Becky Shevlin, come on up. Thank you.
Sitting in that front row is a little, it's a wild ride. Can make you very dizzy. Thank you so much for those kind remarks. Oh. Okay, is that better? Okay, sorry about that. Thank you for those kind remarks, Tom. A little too close. Okay. Good evening, and it's so great to be here together, as Tom pointed out in the beginning. And one thing that I really, really liked, and I've missed so much, as many of you have as well, doing the Pledge of Allegiance all together. All the Zoom Pledge of Allegiance is a cappella, and everybody mutes their mics, or it's a total mess. So it's really nice to be in a room together and be able to say the pledge together. I just thought I'd say that. I did want to acknowledge my husband, who is here tonight, Chris. Love you, honey. So glad to be here with all of you here in the studio, as well as those viewing at home. And so I will get started. It's a little long. I'll just apologize up front. My categories are pretty meaty. Monrovia is an environment where a genuine willingness and desire to learn new things by digging deeper than the surface, conducting respectful dialogue, and making a commitment to inclusion are all working together to better our community. This evening, I am honored to share with you areas which the city has and continues to make strides to be more diverse, equitable, and inclusive. Areas relating to public safety and housing. After civil unrest swept across the nation following the murder of George Floyd, We too, as city staff and leaders, recognize the need to examine ourselves, to identify and address the existence of any and all forms of racism, and raise awareness of the importance of equity, inclusion, diversity, and human rights in our management and governance. This recognition and work for change is a vital part of our relationship with the community we promise to serve and protect. Work which will continue to build on the goal of inclusion, equity, and safety for all Monrovians. Long before the murder of George Floyd, the City Council adopted a resolution condemning racism in all its forms. However, in July of 2020, in order to specifically examine the city's own practices, the City Council approved the formation of a 5-member ad hoc committee on equity and inclusion for the sole purpose of, and I quote, to review with the community to determine whether any policies, practices, and procedures of the City of Monrovia are unjust or unfair, create structural barriers to diversity, equity, and inclusion in city governance, employment, or enforcement, perpetuate systemic racism in the city government, and provide a report back to City Council with any recommendations for change the committee deems advisable for consideration. Through the creation of the ad hoc committee, a series of 15 publicly held meetings via Zoom were held from August 2020 through March 2021. And in May 2021, its comprehensive report was presented to the City Council. The committee performed an in-depth review of all 7 city departments, examining each department's operation and practices. And while we must recognize that racism has been a part of Monrovia's history, it is also important to note that this report made no findings of systemic racism in our city governance, but did offer and highlight a total of 52 recommendations, providing areas where all departments can improve to ensure higher levels of equity and inclusion. City staff evaluated the recommendations, created an action plan, and reported back to City Council in September of 2021, that 19 of the recommendations have been completed with 33 pending. The review and evaluation continue. In terms of other actions of inclusion, it is also to be noted that on July 7th, 2020, the City Council formally declared June 19th as a commemorative holiday to be celebrated each year as Juneteenth National Freedom Day, and encourages the community to honor and reflect on the significant role that African Americans have played in the history of the United States and how they have enriched society through their steadfast commitment to promoting unity and equality. And moving on to a discussion on public safety, unfortunately, Monrovia, as well as so many cities across our state and nation, has experienced an increase in violent crime, including 3 homicides since December 2020. Property crimes plaguing our community, including a proliferation of catalytic converter thefts and crimes, scams and thefts against our seniors, are of great concern, as are the number of unfiled misdemeanor cases presented by our Monrovia PD to the LA County District Attorney's Office for prosecution. After receiving a report on June 1st, 2021 from our police chief, San Victoris, the number of unfiled misdemeanor offenses at that time from the date of DA Gascon's special directive on December 20th, 2020 was alarming in comparison to past practices. The City Council responded with a subcommittee consisting of 2 council members, the city manager and chief of police, to reach out and hold discussions with District Attorney Gascon and his office relating to the impact this is and will have on Monrovia. The committee had robust discussions on broader criminal justice reforms across LA County. These discussions included meeting personally with the DA, with DA Gascon, to discuss his policy reforms and their impacts on Monrovia. Ultimately, not having received satisfactory assurances from DA Gascon or his office, on September 7th, 2021, the matter of a no vote, a vote of no confidence in LA County District Attorney Gascon came before the City Council, and it was passed by a vote of 3-2, with the added directive that the city continue reaching out to DA Gascon, discussions which to date neither DA Gascon or his office have been interested in furthering. For the record, between December 1st in 2020 and September 30th, 2021, Monrovia PD has filed 578 misdemeanor charges, including possession of drug paraphernalia, controlled substance, trespassing, resisting arrest, etc. 269 of those charges were rejected under the DA's special directive. This means one of every two misdemeanor charges is rejected. But please be assured that our officers continue to do an outstanding job in carrying out their duties and responsibilities in serving our community. I didn't think I was going to get any applause throughout this whole thing, so thank you. That we continue to have a very strong community policing team and programs providing outreach throughout the community, including our school resource officer. Let's give another hand to our PD. In other matters concerning safety, the City Council is also aware of the impending closure of LA County Men's Central Jail and the effects of releasing inmates into LA County communities may have, especially considering the majority of those inmates suffer from various degrees of mental illness and substance abuse and addiction. We have been assured that a plan will be in place prior to closure. We continue to monitor this ongoing development. We look to a continuation of criminal justice reforms, including reforms especially relating to the treatment of mental illness and substance abuse and addiction, and how they may impact not only Monrovia, but our region and state as well. I can't overstate that. That is so vitally important. Your council stands united that we must find a way to balance reform and keeping the community safe, and I think that deserves it. Applause. I would like to now discuss housing, one of the council's highest priorities. Our focus has been to find strong partners and developers to build residential development projects, specifically in the Station Square area. We also are strong supporters and a member of the San Gabriel Valley Regional Housing Trust, concentrating on affordable regional housing and shelter options managed through the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments. Coming in March, City Council should be receiving an in-depth status report as to the many successes and future of the Regional Housing Trust. In Southern California, demographic trends indicate population will grow by more than 4 million people in the next 25 years. Combined with real estate prices rising three times faster than household income, finding housing at an affordable price has become difficult, if not impossible. Working with our developers, Monrovia has approved 53 affordable units through our density bonus incentives. While that only begins to scratch the surface of the need, it represents a private investment of $21 million. At its last council meeting, City Council authorized a contract with Sagecrest Planning and Environmental for, in addition to a density bonus ordinance, accessory dwelling unit design guidelines and environmental review, preparation of a proposed inclusionary housing ordinance, which if implemented will require developers to commit a certain percentage of new housing to certain levels of affordability. Sagecrest will be working with an economic feasibility sub-consultant to examine current market conditions to complete and provide an economic feasibility study, as well as recommendations to the Planning Commission and the City Council prior to approval of any inclusionary ordinance. On other housing fronts, in April of 2021, the city, partnering with the California Statewide Communities Development Authority, chose a new workforce housing solution where bonds were issued to purchase the Moda apartments in Station Square. 261 market rate units are now owned by said development authority. Although the city is foregoing $200,000 in annual property tax, residents will receive over $600,000 in rent savings. Oftentimes referred to as housing opportunities for the missing middle, working class responders, public employees, and teachers are given priority housing under a regulatory agreement, and once bonds are fully paid off, the city receives all equity in the property for $1. The best part is the city bears zero financial liability of the property maintenance or cost during the entire agreement. Obviously, there is much more to do. The city is in the final stages of the approval process of our updated general plan, which is our long-range planning document laying out goals and policies to guide future growth. Within the general plan is our housing element and newly required environmental justice element. The housing element focuses on planning for communities' future housing needs and establishing policies, programs, and strategies specifically to address those needs. The goal of the housing element is to plan for safe, affordable housing for all economic segments of our community in a way that is sensitive to our existing neighborhoods. Under state law, we must adequately plan for more than 1,600 new housing units by 2028. These are the regional housing needs assessment numbers, or RENA numbers you keep hearing about, dictated by the state of California. Despite our deeply held concerns around water, traffic, crime, emergency response, and electricity, we must press on and meet these state mandates in a way that preserves our small town charm. The environmental justice element is new and is adopted for the very first time. Certain neighborhoods bear a greater burden than others when it comes to environmental conditions. For example, if you live next to the freeway, you may feel the effects of increased air and noise pollution. If you live in the southern portion of Monrovia, there are fewer trees and parks available. The environmental justice element will focus on neighborhoods that bear increased burdens and guide them towards added solutions to reverse their burden. From issues of social justice reform, law enforcement, to housing and community development, your city council remains focused on building a safer, more inclusive, and welcoming community. And of course, we must and will do this together. And with that, thank you so very much for this time to share this information with you. And let's hear it for 2022 and not look back.
So I get to work with some pretty great people. Give them a hand, please. So give me just a few more minutes. We're almost done here, but we've got some exciting things to talk about. You know, when I was running for election to the mayor's seat back in 2015, my big concern, more than anything, was infrastructure. It seemed like every morning I would turn on the news and there was a water main bursting somewhere. And my big concern was that Monrovia was not taking care of their infrastructure needs. Amazingly, I would go to regional meetings of some of my counterparts, and it seemed like the whole nation was wringing their hands about what to do about infrastructure and how someone else needed to take care of it. I spoke to several mayors at one point, and I said, well, don't you think that's maybe part of your job? And they weren't pleased at that because they thought someone else should do it. So, as mentioned, Monrovia is a mature city, which means our water and sewer systems are close to 100 years old. A satisfactory pavement condition rating is 70 plus. Ours was 57.1. We had streets that, by definition, had failed. Limited resources resulting in piecemeal fixes to stopping a leaky pipe We had 180 water main leaks in 1 year, the year before we started Monrovia Renewal. That's one every other day. One of your water main were leaking. We had replaced cracked sidewalk panels or filling potholes. In order to come up with a solution, four master plans were commissioned to assess the street, sidewalk, water, and sewer systems. So based on our findings and recommendations, we broke ground on a project known as Monrovia Renewal, and you'll all remember that. Thank you. Over $55 million worth of improvements. This is our town. It belongs to us. Somebody needed to take better care of it, and they weren't. This council stepped up, bit the bullet, and did what virtually no other city in America has done, and that said, we need to fix our own problems. We can no longer wait for someone else to do this. So what we've done with the completion of Monrovia Renewal is over 10 million square feet of street improvements, 194,000 square feet of sidewalk replacements, 138,000 linear feet of new curbs and gutters, 2.5 miles of new water pipes, 6 miles of sewer improvements, 281 point repairs to our sewer lines. And if you don't think that's important from a municipal standpoint, have someone turn off your water or turn off your sewer connection for one day, and you'll understand the importance of this. Thank you, Larry. Amen. Over 800 new water service lines were installed. Our pavement condition is now at 87.3. So we know it's not perfect, and we know we need to stay on top of it. So part of Monrovia Renewal is making sure that we have the plan in place to take care of it in the future. There's going to be substantial renovations coming to Library Park, Lucinda Garcia Park, obviously now Canyon Park, right, after the rains. These parks are just one of the reasons that makes Monrovia so special. And I know that, in particular, Canyon Park, if you want to show somebody what Monrovia is about that's visiting here, put them in your car when it's reopened and drive them up to Canyon Park and let them get out of their car and walk around. This is an amazing asset that we have. It's an asset that most communities only dream of. Most communities come over here and visit us because of what we have. But no matter how large or small these projects are, we don't just kick the can down the road. And I have to tell you, I'm pretty passionate about the four people I get to work with. Because for the past almost 7 years now, this city council has taken every step that we needed to take to make sure that we fixed Monrovia. And it's not just the infrastructure, it's the human needs. But in light of the issues we've seen throughout the country regarding the force of law and our new district attorney, and I like to tell everyone that Monrovia is doing as good as we can given the fact that we're still in LA County. Okay, I see that bombed. but we need to put people first, right? And there's a lot of people that are not being put first, so... our seniors welcome the officers from our police department during lunches and special events like Coffee with a Cop or National Night Out. Through these engagements, people get to know what our police department's like. They're just people. We hire them, we give them a job to do, they're part of the community. And if you get to know them, and I think the reason Monrovia has not had some of the issues that so many communities have had is because of our community-based policing, and Alan San Victoris is here. Alan, please give our thanks. So, this is the state of our city. What do you think? Okay, so now I get an opportunity to go off script. Yeah, that's right. Totally off. This is just Tom, right? So I've served for more than 30 years in the town that I love, the town that I was born in, the town that I've lived in for most of my life. I served first on the Planning Commission and then on the City Council. And then when I ran for mayor, I had some very finite goals that I wanted to achieve, primarily involving our infrastructure, which was failing. But I also thought we needed to stop the revolving door at City Hall. I wanted to show my colleagues that the five of us could serve together. And in spite of our differences, there's a reason there's five sets of eyeballs up there. We all have a different life experience, right? We see things a little differently. But when people respect each other, we can work out our differences, and we can come to a common good. Or as Gloria Crudgington has said, we can disagree without being disagreeable. And that's been our goal. Right after my election as mayor, Larry Spicer and I sat down and had a conversation, and it was about how will we move forward. Larry didn't back me as running for mayor, and that's fine. Larry and I sat down and said, okay, here's one thing we're going to do. If we can look at each other in the eye and say what we're about to do is good for the community, then we're both going to do it. But if it's not good for the community, we don't need to talk about it, do we?
Amen.
That's right. So we worked hard to keep Monrovia first. I very humbly think we've done a damn good job. I'm very proud of the fact that this council has served together, improved Monrovia, and brought relative political peace to Monrovia for a longer period than any other council that I can remember.
Amen.
And if you don't think that's important, keep in mind, we have in our grip all of your assets. We take care of them.
Yeah.
Right? You want people who know how to get things done. We've placed our infrastructure in a better spot than any town I know of, and did so while the rest of the nation was wondering what to do about theirs, waiting for someone else to come fix it. This council has managed peace with our employee groups for 7 years and put a stop to the revolving door that plagued City Hall for, I think, 4 years prior to that election. After much thought and conversations with family, friends, supporters, and staff, I feel that I've achieved every single goal I placed on myself when I was first elected as mayor. I also feel after 31 years that if I stay any longer, I'll be staying for my ego and not for Monrovia's ego. And those of you who know me best know that's not what I'm about. So I have decided not to run for re-election in this coming election. So the next election will be in June. The filing starts, I think, Alice, February 14th? February, Larry. Don't be late. Dude, if you're late, you're out. Okay, I'll remind you. So I truly believe in my heart of hearts that I'm leaving Monrovia in a far better position than when I found it. And I say this tonight because there's a filing period that opens up in about 3 weeks or so, and I want everyone to know that I'm not going to be there. So it gives the entire community fair notice. There will be a change on the City Council like we haven't seen in some time. But I leave thanking so many that have supported me, worked with me, voted for me, but my biggest thanks go to the four people to my left. Because if you've ever been in one of these positions, nobody does this alone. And these four people have done an amazing job of taking care of your hometown. And they have made my job so much easier than you could imagine, because they've all focused on the same thing. What's right for Monrovia? And we can all at times agree to disagree, but at some point we need to come together and focus on what's right for the community. And these four people have accomplished that. So please give them another hand. But we're also very, very fortunate to have a great staff, and the leader of that staff is off to my left, your right, Dylan Feek. That, you know, this is a real complex thing called Monrovia, right? There's almost 40,000 people, a lot of money. For every single thing we do, there's 14 different positions on it and 35 different opinions. And at some point, we need to sort through all of that and try to do what we think is right for all of you. And I think, although we're not perfect, and Monrovia is not perfect, I'm here to tell you that this city council has done an extraordinary job of focusing on what was right for the community, and I think they've accomplished that, and I would ask you to join me in giving them a big hand. So on that note, that concludes my remarks, but I'm not going anywhere. I've been here most of my life, and I plan on staying probably till the end of my life, which hopefully will be a long ways off. So my commitment is to continue to work towards a better Monrovia. I know you all do, and I hope we can ramp it up a notch. And I thank you for coming this evening. God bless Monrovia.